Welcome back to Tom's World Scale Model Series. In this episode, we pulled a curtain back on the mysterious and often misunderstood world of model contest judging. If you enjoy programming on scale modeling, then show your support by subscribing to this channel. Leave us a comment, like, dislike, or share the video with friends. Clicking the notification bell gives you alerts when we post new content. Or visit the channel Tom's World for a friendly visit for a complete list of all our videos. Model clubs and hobby shows offer a social aspect to what is otherwise a solitary hobby. There's a lot to be said for quiet time, but sometimes it's nice to connect with people who share our interest in model building. Conventions and contests also give us an opportunity to display our work and to put our skills to the test against other competitive builders. How are model shows judged? What do judges look for? And most importantly, what can we do to improve our standings? Stay with us as we interview a longtime international judge who will answer all the questions we have but we're too afraid to ask. Well, welcome back and thank you so much for visiting with us today. We have a really an amazing guest. He brings with him about 40 years of model building experience. He's been a key executive member of IPMS Toronto and AMPS. He's been judging model shows in Canada and the US, including HeritageCon and Torcan for the past 30 years. And he's organized the Torcan show as chair during the 90s and led the Ajax Ontario show as head judge. He's also judged at many IPMS US national shows and AMPS conventions, including at the World Expo Figure Convention in Chicago. He's only one of 37 AMPS masters since 1994 to have been awarded the judge's Best of Show at the AMPS International Convention. This distinction is shared by such luminaries as Stephen Zaloga and Stephen Cookie Sowell. He also somehow found the time to serve in the Canadian Army, having retired with the rank of second lieutenant. And if all these noteworthy accomplishments weren't enough, he's perhaps best known for his amazing scratch builds and for taming cottage industry resin kits that would vanquish any other ordinary mortals. Mr. Harvey Lowe, welcome to Tom's World.
Wow, Tom. I couldn't even written it better myself. And for the viewers out there, I didn't write that, so because I have a very hard time writing my own bio. So very well said, Tom. And I'm very happy to be with you on this episode.
Well, terrific. And I mean, it's all deserving. So we're really happy to have you here. So let's launch right into it. Some of our viewers might not be aware, but there are modeling clubs out there in the US and Canada. Can you talk just a little bit about these clubs, what goes on at meetings, and what are the advantages of joining a club?
Sure. Model clubs have been around for quite some time. And if we take an example of IPMS Toronto, we started here in Toronto, Canada, way back in 1966. Quite a few of the IPMS chapters around that time had started, it was a very popular hobby back in the 60s. And there may be some chapters much older than that. But in Toronto, we started in 1966. Now, IPMS International Plastic Modeler Society is only one club that runs plastic modeling. It's not to say that all clubs are IPMS. There are many that are not. So really, if you wanted to break it down, there are several types of model clubs. They're at the local level. There are IPMS clubs. There are non-IPMS clubs. And of course, now we have AMPS, the Armor Modeling Preservation Society chapter. We also have car modeling groups as well. So there's a variety of different clubs for people to join, whether they're advanced or beginner modelers.
And what sort of stuff goes on and what are the advantages? I mean, I found the great advantages to be able to just sort of mix people that have the same interests. It adds a little bit of social aspect to modeling, as well as it's a great way to learn.
Indeed. You've hit it all on the nail. Modeling, scale modeling is a very solitaire hobby. We sit in the basement, we work on our model, and there's very little interaction that goes on. And joining a club basically offers that advantage where you're able to share, I'll call it an addiction, with other hobbyists. In fact, today I had an impromptu COVID distancing event at one of my friend's houses with the three of us. So model clubs allow you to engage in that social process where you can talk to other people. That's the most important thing about a model club. And when you talk to people, you learn things. It's one thing to learn off the internet. It's another thing to actually talk to somebody in person and have them show you a technique, and you can learn with that person showing you, COVID notwithstanding right now, but they can demonstrate for you right there. We in Toronto have offered several seminars. that if you join a club, you can partake in. We've offered things like airbrushing for beginners. We've offered decals setting options and how to apply decals. And we also have guest speakers come in and talk about not just modeling, but the history aspect of it. So for example, some notable ones that we've had in the past, we've had an Israeli fighter jet pilot. We had the honor of having a Japanese naval seaman come in and talk about his exploits. He was actually a Canadian during the war who got caught up in Japan. He came in and did a talk. So you go to these clubs to meet people, to gain techniques, to learn a little about the history. And when you learn about these things, it's always better to learn face-to-face and share these common. And plus, getting to look at other people's models face-to-face is of course, way better than looking at a gallery online.
Yeah, and the other thing is, too, is they usually have monthly contests or shows, and then you can kind of get a feel of how you rank within just your club. And then if you get some confidence, you can go on to higher shows.
Absolutely. When I started with the local contests at our local club. You obviously would have some at hobby stores and malls, but when we were young, when it was that youthful age of a teenager, our club president would have monthly contests. And they were big for us because it was the first opportunity for us to compete and learn at that club level. You had to be a member to be in that contest. But I remember those mystical days because you compete for ribbons as a teenager and you could see where you would need improvement and all that. So yes, you start at the local level at contests is very much one aspect of local model clubs.
Yeah, and it might be also good to add that it's very inexpensive. I think the membership here in my little city of Winnipeg is like $25 a month. So in addition to these regional shows, if I really wanted to test myself nationally, what are some of the bigger shows that someone can enter in U.S. And Canada?
Sure. Well, I'll start off with a couple of Canadian examples. Of course, you've got the local. We just talked about the local contests and the local club. Those are very small, get your feet wet. And then we would have what I would consider to be a larger regional show. So in the Toronto area, we would have HeritageCon, which is, in fact, I would say, in my humble opinion, probably one of the largest, if not one, the largest show in Canada. I know Edmonton has a very large one as well. But HeritageCon is the next step up, where you've got, I think one year, two or three years ago, there's well over 700 models on the table. And then you have at least 1,000 or more attendees coming through the door and vendors tables. So those are larger contests where you test your skills, where people would come from various parts of Southern Ontario. We get people coming from New York State, some people coming from Michigan to the HeritageCon show. I have been to other shows in Canada. I know Edmonton's got a big one as well. I don't know about out east, but Montreal's had a few shows. In the States, in the United States, there's lots of regional shows, from AMPS shows. For example, we were in Danbury one year for an AMP show. And then in another year, we were over in Michigan, where they do this kind of like humorous Canadian-US challenge. And they do the show in Detroit. And that's considered to be like a regional show. So we would travel 4 hours to get to that show and meet our American brothers. So you do have that regional scale. And then when you have a regional show, though, you're attracting a lot more people that are more serious about the hobby. And obviously, the competition is going to be a little notch up.
Mm-hmm. And what are the big shows? Like, I know AMPS is big. I know there's a national competition in America.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, AMPS runs local shows, as I said before, but also they do a national convention. And you mentioned something of that in the intro. I very humbly won in 2018, I think, and that was in Buffalo where they had the convention. It rotates. So they will have the AMPS convention run in different cities. So that one year was Buffalo. Another year it was Indianapolis, near Indianapolis. It used to be in Maryland. So you have the AMPS national conventions, but national is used loosely in that context because you would get first-class modelers from all around the world attending these national shows in the U.S. The other big one is the International Plastic Modeler Society National Convention, and that's also held annually in different cities. In this coming year, 2022, heaven forbid COVID you know, goes away, it doesn't really allow us to attend in full attendance, heaven forbid, but it is in Omaha. And I hope to be attending that. Now, the IPMS Nationals, again, much like EPS, although they call it a national show, it's very much international. Overseas, you'd have Telford in the UK. You have Scale Model Fest in Europe. Who knows? There was a show, I think, in Asia that I missed by 2 weeks in Hong Kong. There's a lot of shows in other countries, although they call them national shows. They're international in their scope. So those are basically your levels, your local, your regional, your national, and the nationals are kind of international.
Yeah. So if you're right? really into that competition, there's a lot of choices. So
there are.
Okay. So in terms of contest judging, it seems like the first thing judges take into account are the fundamentals. Can we talk a little bit about more about what those fundamentals are?
Yeah, the terminology we use is fit and finish. That's the term that the judges use. If you're going to enter a model, everything's got to have the proper fit and finish. Fit refers to how well they assembled the model. And that would include things like, are there glue marks? Did you cover your seams and did you fill your seams? How about alignment? Sometimes you put a model together and the wings are a little crooked. How did you fix that? Do you need to correct that? And all those things around fit have to deal with the assembly process and how well you as a modeler can properly put things together. So there's a whole bunch of things in there. I only mentioned a few of them, but just to give you a summary, those are some of the things that the judges look for in terms of fit. Okay. Now, in terms of finish, that would be how well you apply the paint. For example, if you use an airbrush, mastering an airbrush is one of the challenges in the hobby. And I know when I started, one of the biggest challenges I had was orange peel. That's when you have your air pressure that's not properly set. Maybe your paint's not properly mixed to the consistency that it should be. And you end up with this pebbly finish, right? So judges are looking for the finishing aspects of whether it's smooth, is it consistently applied? Are there any bare spots on the plastic? Some guys are so good at it. Their application of the flat and gloss effects are mirror-like. So the finish part is how well the paint has been applied. So those two would be the two things that people primarily look for in terms of fit and finish. But there are other things, and we can talk about a little bit later perhaps, that might be a little more controversial and a little more, a little less objective, like scope of effort and things like that.
Yeah, we'll definitely get there. But I mean, the big ones are usually the wheels, right? That's what usually people get wrong. And then the other challenge is decals, the silvering, you know, does it look like it's painted on? So what we're saying here is that, you know, get those basics first. Don't worry about the fancy aftermarket and everything else. If you enter a model that's very straightforward, but you have the fundamentals solid, you have a good chance of getting passed into the next stage. So I think it's
correct.
Important. Yeah.
Correct. Yeah. In fact, if you don't mind, sorry to interrupt, that if you want to get the fit and finish, part of it is historical accuracy. So one aircraft that comes to mind is the 109, the Messerschmitt 109, right? Its angle of its wheels was a little bit different than other aircraft. And the judges know these things. Although we're not looking to say this 109 is more accurate than that P-51, it's not about historic accuracy that they're judging, but if something is blatantly wrong, that, you know, the wheels on the 109 are just simply at the wrong angle, that will go against you as well. So make sure that you also have some basic idea of the historical concept. Getting into more detailed things like serial numbers won't be a part of the judging because nobody can be an expert on every model. But there are some fundamental things like proper wheel alignment, depending upon the aircraft.
Mm-hmm. And I think another important thing is there's a couple of sets of rules. I think IPMS has a general list of rules and that talks about decals and other things. And then each contest obviously has rules in terms of categories, you know, ages and this, that, and the other thing. And so it's probably important to mention that, hey, if you are going to enter a contest, have a little read of the rules and follow them strictly.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. Read the rules properly. First of all, the first thing you got to read properly is the judging rules, right? Make sure that you're in the proper category, Make sure that you follow the judging requirements. For example, the age category and all that. Make sure you're in the right age grouping. But then there are other things, like you mentioned scratch building. Every show has slightly different definition of scratch building. And if you do have a model that's scratch built and you're going to call it scratch built, make sure that you understand the definition that the show organizers have for that category so that you can say, yes, mine is scratch built. For example, and I'm just throwing this out, some of the definitions for scratch building, for example, say that a model has to have X percentage of the model made by your own hands. It's not by a commercial company. Others have a different criteria. So those little things, just make sure that you understand them so that you get your model in the proper category.
And it's always an option to write an email or make a phone call to the organizers beforehand and say, hey, can I clear this up with you? And because again, it's terrible to kind of work hard at this and then get to the show and realize that, you know, maybe it doesn't fit in the right category
or, that's right,
you know, you've done it incorrectly. So spare yourself the anguish, right?
Absolutely. Here's another one that a lot of people get tripped up on is if you're entering a diorama versus a vignette. Right? Diorama is a bigger storytelling piece. A vignette is usually like one piece with a couple of figures. That one, in my experience, has varied the most from show to show, the differences between a diorama and a vignette. Now, you can have an option to enter a category if you state it up front. So let's say that Tom, you built a P51 Mustang diorama with a figure on it and a little Jeep. Now, most cases, people would look at that and go, you know what, that's a vignette. But if you put on your form, I know it's a vignette, I know it's got a figure, but ignore those. I really want to enter the aircraft in the aircraft category. Most shows will let you do that. Right? You have that option, which means that the little accessories in the base will not count in the judging and only your aircraft will. So you do sometimes have that option.
Okay, fair enough. So I've heard there's basically two types of judging. I've heard it called the 1-2-3 method and the other one's the open judging method.
Yes.
Can you kind of explain them and contrast them a little bit?
Sure. First of all, even before I get into that, it's highly controversial, the two judging systems. There's constantly debate, banter, arguing over the merits of one and another. Now, I can say in my experience, I've judged both. And first of all, let's start with the definition. The 1-2-3 system is typically the most familiar to people, first, second, third, right? There's only a first, there's a second, and there's third. There may be ties. Some shows even allow two firsts, but rarely. Usually it's a first, a second. They may allow a tie and a second, and a third. They may allow a tie and a third. They might even have an honorable mention. But that's the system that's called 1-2-3. And typically it's a system that only allows one number one winner. There's only one. Now, open judging is a little bit different. Open judging is where you could have, let's say there's 10 modelers. In a 1-2-3, there's only one winner. There's only one of 10 that's going to get that first. But open system, if you have the 10 modelers, you could actually have, now we don't typically call them 1-2-3, first, second, third. We call them gold, silver, and bronze in an open system. You could have five of those 10 modelers get golds. You could have still only have one get gold and the rest are silvers. Any of those combination, because technically and in theory, what the judges are doing is they're looking at whether or not you've got fit and finish, but whether it's, they're looking at the whole breadth of models in that show, which one of all of the entries would be considered a gold standard. And then they would look at the other models and say, all right, we've got this really, really good gold Tiger tank. You know, do the others, are they at that same level? Then they would also get a gold. If they don't, they would get a second, they would get a silver and a bronze. Typically, they look at the breadth of skill at that show, and it's a denominator. They would look at what is the denominator here, what is the best model at this show, and then we'll use that as a yardstick to determine what is a gold standard, what is a silver standard, what is a bronze. And typically with the open system, such as that used at AMPS, there's a sheet with mathematical numbers on it. So for fit, you'll get, you know, X number of points out of 10, right? Out of finish, and they'll go through those things. There's even a scope of effort in there, and they have bonus points if you model an actual armored vehicle that is based on a photo and you can prove it, because their whole thing in the hobby is about armor preservation. If you're going to be building like a sci-fi Gundam armored vehicle, AMPS is probably not the place to take that. That would be at a Gundam plus show. But for AMPS, they're looking at that fit and finish, scope of effort, and historical accuracy. And they would have little boxes where you would apply math numbers. And if you are to score a gold, you have to get a certain number of points out of the total. I think the total right now is 30. So a gold would be anything higher than, I think, a 27 or 28. Correct me if I'm wrong. But then the silvers would be a number down from that when you add up all the scores. And they would be very statistical in eliminating any that are severe outliers. So they do their best to apply a mathematical formula and a score. Now, for 1, 2, 3, in my experience, they don't do that. Maybe some shows they do, but the ones I've attended, they've never really applied a checking scoring system. It's just a group of guys that go in there and you all huddle together and you make a judgment. The only thing that's probably common to those two systems is both systems at a national level require you to take some form of training for judging. So they won't just... You just can't walk into an AMPS convention and say, hey, I build models, can I be a judge? And the same with IPMS Nationals, they won't let you do that. You'll have to take either a simple course or you can become, a part of a group where you're a trainee and you're not actually judging with the other judges, but you're looking at them and you're gaining experience. We've done that a lot at the national level to bring somebody in so they can listen in and we bring them up the ropes. So those are just kind of like general description. To sum it up, a 1-2-3 system is a peer competition system. There's only one winner. It's a contest, and that's what those are seen of. The open system is really and these are my own words, there may be people that will debate this, but that's more of a recognition of one's skill and ability, right? So you and I can both be golds, so, because you and I have roughly the same skill in achieving that level of piece that we build. So that's really more of a recognition of your ability. The only difference, exception to that, is that the AMPS National Convention, as you mentioned before, there is a master's award where the judges pick anybody who's gotten almost a perfect score or a perfect score. The head judges would say, all right, now out of these, we're going to vote, we're going to look at them, and we're only going to pick one best of show. That's probably the only exception in the AMPS show where there's only one winner. There's only one AMPS best in show master for every show. And you mentioned there were, 36 so far.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Well, which system is more fair or better is we'll have to leave to the viewers.
And that'll do it for this part one of our model contest judging interview. Check back soon for part two, where we conclude our discussion and reveal more insider tips of how to improve your scoring method in model contests. If you haven't already, why not subscribe to the channel or leave us a like, dislike, share the video, or just grumble in the comments. Otherwise, visit the channel Tom's World for a neighborly visit and for a complete listing of all our entertaining and educational videos. In the meantime, concentrate on your fit and finish, stay well, and all the best for the new year.